My PPT, I have tried to kind of cover the concept of universal health coverage, as well as why do we need universal health coverage, you know. So for that, it is very important to understand something basic about health financing, like who pays for our health treatment, you know, who pays for our health, and how various mechanisms of paying for that health influence the outcomes, you know, like what outcomes the poor people will have or general population will have depends on who is financing and who is providing the care. So I have tried to cover as much as I could think was, you know, was possible in 35 minutes. So I will begin my presentation now. I'll be happy to take questions in the end. I mean, if there are any questions. Basically, I'm going to explain, you know, since I also work on, I do not work for health insurance TPA. I work only for Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana from the World Bank as a technical support team. And all of us work in National Health Authority, which is in Delhi. So I'll just explain to people here what is Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana before I move on to UHC and health financing, etc. So just a little bit of, you know, this Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, which in Kerala is called, I think it is Kerala Arogya, one second, I just had the name of, because Karuna Arogya Suraksha Padhati, CASP, that is what it is called here in Kerala, because every government, every state government has given a local name which people associate more than Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, Ayushman Bharat, what we call as Ayushman Bharat. And Kerala, in any case, let me inform you, is doing very well in the scheme. People are availing benefits, around 300 crore, you know, benefits have been utilized from, I think, last 4 months. So, I mean, a lot of families are covered. I think around 50% of Kerala's population is covered in that. So the features of Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, you know, 5 lakh covered per year per family, and it includes the hospitalization episodes, pre and post hospitalization. There are around 1393 procedures which are covered, and this is totally cashless, paperless scheme. There is no cap on the family size or gender or age. So if you have seen that in private insurance, usually there is a cap on the when you can join an insurance, or there are, if there are pre-existing conditions, you are not allowed. But there is no such exclusion here in Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, and benefits are portable across the country. So if a person from Maharashtra is working in Kerala, or a Kerala beneficiary is working in any other part of the country, they can avail benefits there without any problem. Absolutely, this is totally portable. So far, the report card of Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana is around 10 crore, 11 crore people have got, you know, their golden cards issued, and entitled people are 50 crore Indians are entitled for the scheme all over India, including Kerala, and there are 52 lakh people have availed of benefits, around 8,000 crores have been utilized. Kerala joined very recently, it joined around few months back. So that is how it is, you know, it's just, I think, 4 months back it joined. So 300 crores have been paid so far. Around 18,000 plus hospitals are empaneled. And just I mentioned the portability cases. So around 50,000 people have availed benefit at a different place where they usually reside. So that shows the portability of benefits. Number of hospitals empaneled, since this is a private hospital and a large private hospital, so in the scheme, we always encourage that private hospitals should participate. Why so? I mean, in Kerala, of course, the public hospitals are doing very well, and you know, they are equally preferred by the patients. But all over India, that's not the state. You know, barring a few states in India, most of the people prefer to go to private hospital if given a choice. If they have a choice of not having to pay for private treatment, they would prefer a private facility over a public facility. That is the experience all over India. So if you look at the two pie charts, so far the, you know, the 63 lakh claims have happened from the private sector. The blue is the private sector, whereas the number is less. The number of public hospitals is more than the private hospitals, But the consumption of utilization of benefits in private hospitals is far higher, which is because, you know, the people prefer, you know, that if there is a choice, they would like to have, you know, hospitalization at a private hospital. And then in case of Kerala, I think I'm told that around 180 hospitals, private hospitals are empaneled. May not be the most, the top tertiary ones because of the costing issues, because of the package pricing issues. I hope that someday that would be resolved and we will come to a middle path where, you know, the scheme can afford to pay hospitals what their reasonable demand is. And maybe the hospitals will also come halfway and then, you know, meet there. Now coming to the main topic of topic about USG and health financing. You know, whenever we fall sick, we dip into our pocket, isn't it? Or if we are covered by an employer, then we dip into the pocket of the employer. Or if the employer has also been taking contribution from us, so we contribute. So there are various ways, you know, health is financed. Basically, health financing is about collection of money, revenue, then pooling of that money and the risk, and resource allocation. So you have, you know, resources allocated to primary health care, preventive health care, secondary care, tertiary care, over, you know, maternal health, over, you know, neonatal health, over geriatric care, over, you know, NCDs. So then those resources are allocated for different segments of the population, for different ailments or for different issues that they may face. So then from those pooled money and resource allocation, the payment is made to the hospitals. This is the very broad basic concept of health financing. Now, when any country is trying to do a health financing for its, you know, for its citizens, there are certain basic concepts. Like in India, we are aware that from the time of independence, Government of India tried to, along with the state government, health is a state subject. So Government of India and the states have been involved in setting up government facilities, isn't it? From the sub-center, block level, district level hospital, community level hospital, to the district level hospitals. So that's the supply side financing. So you are the supply of healthcare, those institutions which will look after the healthcare are being financed by the government from the government funds. Now over a period of time, that has not been sufficient. That is how private hospitals have come up. So the objectives of health financing is how to raise sufficient and sustainable revenue in an equitable and efficient manner. Now we know that in India, we have a very large unorganized sector. You know, our tax collection, income tax collection and the tax collection is not that high because 70-80% of our population is still on the unorganized side. So how do you collect revenue from them? How do you collect taxes from them? You know, there is no way. They're already poor people and their source of income is not so certain. So how do you raise funds from them, you know, when they're already not, you know, in the organized sector? So that is the challenge for us. Then managing the funds, you know, well, efficiently and equitably. As I explained, from the time of independence, we set up government hospitals. If you remember, in my childhood, I do not remember a private hospital. I do remember private doctor, physician, you know, near home, a physician whom we will go, to whom we will go for small, you know, cough, cold, fever. But I don't remember going to a private hospital. Now, I don't think our children know going to a public hospital. So the whole shift has happened. The whole shift has happened because the supply side financing has not delivered the desired results perhaps. It was perhaps not so efficient. It was perhaps not so, you know, enough. Maybe it wasn't enough. Maybe it wasn't managed well. So then comes the question of how do you give every citizen of India, every citizen of the country, access to a defined package, you know, that you have vaccination, you have, you know, the common, you know, screenings, you have common, you know, primary care. How do you give that benefit package? How do you, you know, allocate your resources so that everyone has access to that? Now, people like us who are sitting in this hall are very fortunate. We have resources. We have friends, we have family to whom we can turn to in case our own resources are inadequate. But imagine a person who's living on a daily wages, or even above that daily wage worker, who is just earning some 10, 20,000, 15,000 rupees, making two ends meet, having to receive a health shock. Imagine a person, you know, that, and imagine if that number is running into 50, 60 crores. What do you do? So I think that is the issue of health financing, which our country is facing, which we collectively are trying to find answers. So this is the amount of money. One is the question of amount of money. The second is how the money is spent. Is it like, let's assume that this, I explained to you that 8,000 crore have been spent in Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, and 75% funds have gone to the private hospitals. Supposing these funds were again going to the public hospitals, would that be a good use of money? Or is it good use of money that there are private hospitals who have created infrastructure, who have doctors, who have nurses, who have everything that it takes, and pay them for the treatment of these people who could not be treated in public hospitals? So these are the complex issues of health financing, which health financing tries to address. So health financing can be in various ways, you know, various ways. So that can be, you know, government revenue collection, as I said, taxes, or it could be social health insurance. People come together as a community level and say, okay, we will all put 100 rupees each, and any one of us falling sick, we will fund. That is a social health insurance. Or external sources, we could get donations, or it could be private insurance that we could have, or it could be out of pocket. This last thing, out of pocket, the purple, this is a major culprit. As I explained, that if poor people have to spend at the time of a health shock out of pocket, they would avoid going to a hospital. They would avoid going meeting a doctor because they simply do not have money, right? So that is the whole issue that our country is facing. We have done very well, we have done reasonably well that health outcomes, you know, we have a steady, increase in our life expectancy. So it has increased from, you know, from where we were at the time of independence, from 60 now to 70, we are, you know, getting closer to the developed countries. But our sheer Indian government budget, the all budget of the government, whether state or center, is very less on health. We are spending around 4% of the government money on the health, which leads to, if government spends low money, people still are requiring money to be spent because they are falling sick, they need to access care. How do they go about it? Then they go out of pocket. So this pie charts, this my presentation will be here. So any one of you want to refer to it? Yeah, I mean, this is already saved with Dr. Bijon, so you can look at it. So this pie chart explains which country is financing its health from which resources. If you look at the top left corner is what India is, and this orange color is out of pocket. So that is the state of affairs that we presently have. 60%, more than 60% of our health spend is coming from out of pocket. Now, if it is coming from out of pocket, obviously people are, you know, it shifts the health seeking behavior of the population. So they do not seek care when they need to, and they delay it. They delay it, it becomes more catastrophic. So there are implications to out of pocket, not only, you know, that people become poor, as I will explain, that, you know, when out of pocket is high, this is the same chart presented in a different way for some countries, right? And so when out of pocket is high, more people are being pushed to poverty. So we have around 30 crore people, or, you know, the numbers vary, you know, now the definition of poverty itself, you know, keeps on getting debated, you know, whether it's $2, whether, you know, what's the, you know, value that we should consider a person poor. But safe enough to assume that around 300 million people plus definitely get pushed to poverty because of health shocks every year. Just imagine every year, we are talking about every year, what magnitude of the problem that we are talking about. So if financing is in, you know, so low public financing is leading to high out-of-pocket spending, there is a poor supply side readiness, people have to pay for everything, high utilization of out-of-pocket is happening at private facilities, it deters and delays utilization, leads to foregone care, makes it difficult to have collective, you know, collective pooling. So it is a very inefficient, inequitable way of financing healthcare. So out-of-pocket is the least preferred method of financing healthcare. Unfortunately, India is where it is today. But of course, with so many good hospitals in the private sector, so many youngsters taking up startups to solve our problems, including healthcare problems, we are not going to be here. From here, the positive story begins. I think I kind of, you know, I can see around the faces are really glum because I painted such a, you know, such a picture. But believe me, we are on a better improvement now. We are on an improvement path. Every state government and the central government now for the last few years have started taking active efforts. So active efforts means, so far we were doing the supply side financing. We were creating institutions from the government money. Now we started doing demand side financing. So Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana is an attempt in demand side financing. So demand side financing is giving power and money to the purchaser of healthcare. So in a way, when these people are being covered under Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, 50% of Kerala. So in a way, they have been empowered. They have not been paid money, but they don't need to pay money when they access healthcare. So they have been empowered. They are the demand side people. So they have been empowered. They have been financed. So they can go to an institution and access care. And believe you me, even the public hospitals are charging in India. Public hospitals are not free. I mean, we say that they are free. Sometimes they charge for medicine, sometimes they charge for diagnostics, sometimes they charge for, you know, for implants, and then there are waiting periods. So it's not that, you know, everything is, you know, is free in public sector. So even for public sector institutions, public facilities, the payment is happening. This is about a slide about low hospitalization rate among the bottom. Poor mainly rely on the government hospitals. Now the four health shocks, you know, I have already explained that it makes it unpredictable, uncommon. So this is, you know, this is just four health shocks. These are unwanted and undesirable, you know. So universal health coverage. Now coming to the, so in the universal health coverage, in the population, what we are trying to do is to pool the population so that there is a cross-subsidization. Because if you are doing out-of-pocket, then there is no cross subsidy between the family. Of course, my child may not fall sick and I may fall sick, but when you do it at a total level, so there is a cross subsidy from low risk to high risk. Like in the hospital also, you will have patient case load, right? Every patient is not that severe, you know, so there is a level of care which is less, more complex, ICU, so you have different types of, you know, patient mix. So there is a cross subsidy from low risk to high risk, cross subsidy from rich to poor. This is where, you know, rich to poor, we can say that we rich are being, rich people are already being taxed, you know, and our tax money is going to the government schemes, so we are already subsidizing. But that's a very indirect way of the money reaching, you know. But if you pool at the, for the health benefits, then the cross subsidy happens quickly for the specific purpose. And cross subsidy from the productive to non-productive life cycle. So young people looking after the, you know, old, as we will grow old, and one of the challenges that is going to come in coming times is the longevity. We said the life expectancy has gone up, but that's coming with challenges, you know. So after 70, 60, 70, how many of us will remain productive, and what kind of a, you know, health burden that we may create, you know, for the country or for the, you know, for the entire society. So there is a cross subsidy concept here, which is, so I have explained that the disadvantages of out of pocket. Let me explain the concept of prepayment or pooling. What universal healthcare tries to do is, let us pool, and I explain to you the subsidization. So pooling, when you do pooling, you know, at a gross level, at a, you know, 130 crore Indian level, how many will fall sick. You cannot say who will fall sick, but you can say approximately how many will fall sick, right? And if how many will fall sick, what is the average expense that they will likely to incur? You do not know particular person who will fall sick, for what he will fall sick, but at a population level, it becomes predictable. So the pool becomes a little more manageable risk pool, so which ensures the predictability. And supposing if we were to say 130 crore Indians require so much of spending on healthcare, no, we could just multiply into, you know, 2000 rupees, 3000 rupees, and then we could see that now this is the requirement. Now who pays for it? That becomes the second question. So we have calculated the, you know, pooling impact, the prepayment impact. Presently in India, we have very fragmented risk pools. So there is a RSBY, earlier it used to be RSBY, there is a out-of-pocket, there is a CGHS, there are state government schemes, there are state government employees, public sector employees. So if you have very fragmented risk pools, it becomes very inefficient. Again, it becomes very inefficient. So the risk pools also have to be homogenized, have to be brought together in a efficient and logical manner. So that's where we are trying to go about with PMJ. Now I come to the concept of universal health coverage. It means ensuring that all people can use promotive, preventive, curative, rehabilitative and palliative health services they need of sufficient quality to be effective, while also ensuring the use of these services does not expose the user to financial hardship. So it talks about the different types of care that should be made available. These should be of sufficiently good quality, you know, to be effective, and the financial hardship should not be caused. That is in nutshell the summary concept of universal health coverage. So what we are referring to as universal health coverage is access to services in an affordable, equitable and assured quality without being the risk of financial hardship. So there are three concepts to this. I will come to the next one. So what is the number of people covered is the first concept of UHC. How many people are covered? That is the first thing, you know, how many people are covered. Then second, for how much financial extent they are covered. And then third, what are the services they are covered for? So there are three aspects of universal. These are called breadth, width and scope in technical parlance. This is called. So this is the concept of universal health coverage. How many people are covered? For what extent, what financial extent they are covered? And what are the services they are covered? Are they covered for primary, secondary, tertiary? Now primary health care, Ayushman Bharat wellness centers, is free for every Indian. Government of India has you know, decided that the 150,000 sub centers all over India will be converted to wellness centers, where the screening, vaccinations, so far all our sub centers have been very kind of confined to maternal health care, you know, the institutional deliveries or vaccination programs. Now they are being converted into a holistic kind of a community based requirement of, you know, preventive. And I think the doctors sitting here, the hospital administrators who are sitting here, would know the crucial, important aspect of primary care. I think nobody can deny. If we could do that well, I think the patient load and the focus on this, I mean, the secondary care and tertiary care will only be for a very limited number of people. But because we are not taking care at that level, so all people are landing here. Because at that level they are ignoring or they are not accessing. So they are all coming to the hospital when the situation has aggravated. So this is about universal health coverage. This is also a sustainable development goal of the UN. It is not that universal health coverage. In 2012, every country adopted this resolution. And this is a sustainable development goal number 3. That target is achieve universal health coverage. Indicator is what will be the indicator, like that coverage of essential health services and financial protection from, you know, out of pocket. So these are the two indicators which UN has decided, WHO has decided, that any country, how a country will be assessed, that how much universal health coverage it has achieved, what will be the indicators. What I explained to you, the broad concept of depth and the, you know, the number of people covered, for what services they are covered, for what protection, for what value they are covered, this is a very typical, it's called UHC cube. So there are three dimensions, and to what extent the government of the country has reached is called that is the extent to which it has achieved UHC in a way. So there are, you know, World Bank and WHO has recommended, you know, there are traces, like it will be too humongous a task if we say 130 crore Indians, they should have access to everything and then that will be UHC. No, I think the international bodies and governments realize it's going to be a journey. It's going to be a journey. So there are indicators, you know, that let's begin with one indicator, then the second indicator. So there are preventive and promotive indicators. There are treatment related indicators. There are financial protection related indicators. So as the country is progressing, as the country and India is a little behind, but we can see that we are on the right path. At least we are on the right path for the last few, I think last 7-10 years, and from 2012 having signed this. So we are on the right path at least. And it is of course the collective effort of government, of private providers, of the community, of the population, of the, you know, non-government sector, all coming together and making it happen. So these are the tracer indicators. They are also depicted in a kind of a, you know, pictorial way, that how many presently, what are the number of people who are facing extreme poverty, what is the number of people who have uncontrolled hypertension, what is the number of women who are likely, you know, who do not have access to safe family planning methods, or what are the infants who are, you know, this is gives a size of the, you know, the numbers that are yet to be, you know, that are to be achieved by everyone together. Now coming to this, you know, Pradhan Mantri, this CASP, let me refer to Kerala specific. So in the bigger cube of USC, this is what 5 lakh cover, 250 crore people, that is what the CASP, Pradhan Mantri Ayushman Bharat is doing. It has extended 5 lakh cover to 12.5 crore families, you know, secondary and tertiary care procedures are included, and 5 lakh is the cover. Now, 5 lakh is reasonably sufficient cover to begin with. We definitely cannot include organ transplants and higher, you know, quaternary care procedures. Which is not negotiable. Like for example, children's education. I think no family compromises on that, because that is the top priority. They may not go to cinema, they may not go to eat out, but they will definitely ensure children's education. Like that in health also. So Government of India along with the states have thought that preventive and promotive and primary care is going to be looked after for every Indian in those wellness centers. Plus the catastrophe expense of hospitalization will be looked after for these 50 crore people or 12.5 crore families for up to 5 lakh. That is what the present, you know, the scenario is. Along with this, there are other schemes of the government and the state governments, where, you know, large number of, you know, states like Chhattisgarh, Meghalaya, a lot of states have expanded the cover. Some states have included more population. Therefore, the estimated, you know, that we are estimating is around 65 to 70 crore population has got some kind of a cover with under Ayushman Bharat or with the state extension schemes. This is the, you know, a picture of, I will mail you the, I think even in my updated PPT which I sent today, I forgot to add a map of Kerala. I'll send a specific slide on Kerala. I had it, I forgot to add it. So I will send you the slide about Kerala, because that would be of more interest to you, that how Kerala is, you know, is performing on that coverage. Now, coming to the second part. Now, we understood there is an out-of-pocket expense. How Government of India and state governments are trying to reduce that out-of-pocket expense for the poor people through scheme like CAS and Ayushman Bharat. Along with that, we do have private health insurance in the country. We have CGHS, we have, you know, we have ESIC. So we have, you know, these people are along with the PMJ, they are working along with that. So they are covering around, you know, CGHS and ESIC around, we estimated is around 15% of people are covered. Then there are armed forces clinics and there are railways clinics, railways hospitals. So all together around 15% of the population. So we are estimating around that India has given financial protection of some sort if we include Ayushman Bharat, if we include CGHS, ESIC, railways, armed forces, private health insurance, all together around 80% of the population. That still leaves, can you imagine, that still leaves around 40 crore people out. Because we are 130 crore going to be nearly, 130 crore. So if you have 20% of that, is around 30 to 40 crore people is what we call as a missing middle. So poor people are covered by the government, top people, employees are covered by their, you know, by the government bodies, or the CGHS types, or the railways, and the middle income people, it's the lower middle income and the middle income people who are still exposed to this financial risk. And mind you, we are not a very high developed country. Our GDP, our per capita income is still lower middle income countries. We are just reaching there. So our, when we are referring about the middle income group or the lower middle income group, they are not very rich people. They are also, if they are exposed to that risk of, you know, paying from pocket, they could very well become poor, you know, because if they have to sell a house or, you know, sell jewelry or, you know, keep it mortgage, or they have to be off job for 6 months, they could soon be, you know, going back to poverty, right? So it is the now the target of the government programs and the everyone is, how do we cover this missing middle? Now, as I said, any family's budget is limited. Government's budgets are also limited. They are not unlimited budgets. So you got to have, the discussion that is happening is that this missing middle, maybe some kind of a contributory scheme should come up where they pay for their premium in a very affordable manner. Government of India negotiates with insurance companies or with, you know, or creates a risk pool where, you know, maybe a 500 per month or a 700 per month or 300 per month, we don't know. The actuarial costing is yet to be done for this missing middle. But they could be, you know, paying premium per month or, you know, and that could be deducted, you know, through mobile or through bank, and they could be covered. They could buy this cover. So this is a discussion which has just started happening in Niti Aayog and in the Government of India and in the insurance industry. So where we are talking about, how do we cover this? Mind you, the people who are also covered, for example, those 80% people, definitely they still have some requirements which are not covered. I talked about organ transplant. Primary and promotive healthcare is though free, but is it available? So now I come to the role of private, since we are having an audience from private healthcare providers. So we are fortunate in India that we have a very strong private healthcare provider sector. It has really helped, even though I don't know if it was by design or by it happened, but we have a very nice, strong, thriving private healthcare sector in India, which has helped, which is going to help, which has helped and which is going to help further the Government of India in its effort to give universal health coverage to its population. This is the, you know, size of the market, that even today 74% of total health expenditure in India is utilized in private healthcare, in private providers. So 74% of the hospitals are private. Though of course the number of beds in public are quite high, the 60% beds in public. So medical tourism is growing at the rate of 25 to 27%. So this is where the private role of private sector comes into play. So that is where we have a thriving private sector, which is growing, which is a huge, huge support to looking after the health of, you know, Indians. But of course, there are certain paradoxes of Indian healthcare. We have made, you know, private health sector is existing along with extreme poverty. So extreme poverty is there. Quality of care, you know, how a hospital like this is an example. Nobody needs to, I think, even look at the data, but I think ma'am was telling about patient safety being number one. I'm sure, I mean, there nobody needs to even look at the data. One would know for sure. But that's not true of every private healthcare provider. You know, there are small clinics, there are large clinics, and then the financing issues that I discussed about. Yeah. So what is, this is my second last slide. I don't think I'll need the second ring. The role of private sector in supporting universal health coverage, you know, kind of a, I think the business model which private sector had was private health insurance and the rich people. Maybe India is a mass market, you know. So let's, I think maybe the time has come to build hospitals which can be afforded by masses, you know. Maybe how do you do it? I do not know the answer. I am on the other side. So how do you make affordable cost of care with efficient low cost infrastructure, replacing the high cost infrastructure is something which the private providers perhaps need to start thinking about. You know, how do you, if look at it from a marketing perspective, there is a market of 100 crore people. If 70 crore people, 70% people can afford only this much, you got to create market, you got to create your goods and services for that. You have chota recharge, you have a shampoo sachet, you have everything sachet in India because people could afford it. 1 rupee shampoo sachet, which a rural woman could afford it. Now, you know, there's so much talk about, you know, this Swachh Bharat and, you know, the female hygiene products which are being made available at a low cost. So India is a market of low cost. So I think the private providers, of course, tertiary care would have certain bare minimum requirements. We are not saying that it can be delivered, like ICU cannot run without an AC, right? Or without a basic infrastructure. And enhancing the capacities in unreached areas. Maybe I'm very thrilled when we hear about projects like, you know, a medicine ATM or a telemedicine, you know. So such projects will, you know, make you reach the, you know, unreached areas, because it's very difficult to get resources there. And moving beyond curative care in hospital settings, I think if we will also focus on a holistic manner, just not the curative part in the hospital, we would be, you know, kind of moving towards a mass market. This would be, you know, my request and, you know, request to the private providers, you know, who are here. And so the way forward for us is, you know, like we are universalizing the beneficiary coverage and we are ensuring access. We are integrating care. Now the good part is now we are, you know, India is very digital savvy. So this scheme is totally digital and the hospital here is totally digital, which is making it very easy to integrate, you know. So I think the government of India has come up with a, recently released, Honorable Minister of Health has already released National Digital Health Mission, whereas every Indian will have a unique ID. And that ID will be tracked, what access he or she tracked, irrespective of where it happened. It could happen in government setting, it could be public, but at least a recording of the whole, you know, the vertical and horizontal, you know, integration of is to happen. And of course, we have to work very actively to keep the bad apples out and, you know, fraud part and the abuse and the waste part, we have to reduce that. And that's where I end. Thank you. Bye. In US, there is no unorganized sector. In India, 70% of the people are working on daily wages, on, you know, on who earn in cash. So even though you know, PM has, you know, tried to move everyone to banking, but our informal sector is too high. How do you raise taxes? We are already having very high level of income tax and GST. I don't think we want more taxes, right? because we are the few ones paying for a large number of people who are untaxed. So I think that that's one way. So that is how the demand side financing. If you cannot tax people, how do you, you know, empower them, you know, through the demand side financing? On four PPP models, I think regarding this PPP models, I would like to hear from you rather than from myself, you know, that we feel that those models are good, and I am personally of the view that joining of hands is very important, because if 74% of people are preferring to go to private providers, how do you amalgamate them with the overall scheme of things, whether it is dialysis, whether it's tertiary care, whether it is, you know, land, whether it is diagnostics, whether it's cancer, you know. Now slowly and gradually the PPP will go on increasing. That's my view. In PPP there is a responsibility on both sides, that none should exploit the other, you know, that there should be a balance. In PPP model there should be a balance which is not tilted towards any party. It should not be tilted towards government either. It should not be tilted towards private party either. So that is, I think, more challenge on the PPP side, is maintaining the balance and having an effective model which delivers on a long-term basis.
And the last question?
Yeah, I will answer that. So the reluctance of private hospitals has been due to the package rates that are offered, right? That there is no two opinions about it, that all of them have made themselves very clear. Last month, the governing board of National Health Authority, which is led by the Honorable Health Minister, we have improved the package rates of 300 plus packages. So that is phase one. So, you know, like, we are depending on a body called DHR, a Department of Health Research, which is coming under Ministry of Health. They have carried out the detailed costing study of government hospitals, right? So, and they had these, you know, committees. Dr. Gyani, I think, would be able to, you know, include it in his speech, maybe, you know, he has been part of those committees. So there were technical specialist committees of 24, 26 specialties where they met, where they agreed that this procedure should be revised to this extent. We are fully aware, I think this job is not yet done. But it is something is better than nothing. So to start with, that phase one has happened. Now DHR is now going to have the study conducted through involving the private hospitals in a bigger way. So that's going to take some time. So without waiting for that, this was rolled out so that some relief gets, you know, provided to the hospital. If you look at it, see, the reluctant hospitals are the ones which are very, you know, tertiary and corporate and, you know, very high-end facilities. The lower-end facilities, secondary facilities have been very participating, and you saw that, you know, around 8,000 hospitals, and they are heavily utilized, 8,000 hospitals. What our concern is whether there should not be any abuse in those hospitals is our concern, not the utilization part. We are happy that people are going. Let a patient vote by, it's voting by feet, you know, where I walk, where I buy, I declare the hospital to be good. And we are looking at the data, the readmission rates and the mortality rates are not too bad. Like they are, what they is there in the market, what is there for the industry or for the private, it's not that the care is being offered very less. So I think on the package, if you could, we would do that exercise. You add the NABH 15%, you add a teaching hospital, or you add the cost of care for a metro town. I think what we have to do is that a city like Calicut may not be categorized as a metro town. So I think if we add that, so it becomes 39% additional. That will come somewhere closer to your bare cost. It will maybe less than bare cost. But what we are saying is that there has to be, there is a restraint on the funding side. Like there cannot be a funding that can be, you know, made available right from day one. But it's a journey. And I think I would suggest, please have a dialogue with the private hospitals who are part of the journey. Like there are 178 hospitals in Kerala who are part of the journey. Please do have a word with them. How are they managing and what level of care, maybe the level of care they are offering is not these high-end procedures, they are the lower-end procedures. In Kerala actually, it's a happy coincidence that public hospitals are doing very well. I mean, in RSBY and here also, I think more than 50-60% utilization is going for public hospitals, because they are competing like private hospitals. They've improved their infrastructure. That's what we are we had a very famous slide in RSB where it is before and after of couple of health centers in Kerala. I have not visited those, but that's what I have heard. But having said all this, it's a process. It's not, you said it's very small, it's peanuts. But let's say that it's a process which has begun. It's not that we have said that process has ended, but that's where the process is presently. And that's where I think the affordability is presently. Maybe both sides would, you know, evolve. The private hospitals, like what our CEO always says, the NHS CEO is always saying, that please look at us, look at the scheme for a only marginal cost, you know, or your operating cost. We can only afford to pay you for that. So I think, and then there has been a lot of dispute about what is an operating cost. Now, if you run your hospital efficiently, your operating cost will be lower. If a hospital has a lot of waste, you know, in its processes, its operating cost. So there have been a lot of debates about it. So there is, you know, so Department of Health Research, DHR and ISMR together have done this. We have to, you know, presently respect that. I have not been part of it. Dr. Gyani would be answering that question, right? Thank you very much.